You have 2 hours to tell a story spanning 15 years, introduce a ton of characters that impact your plot, and set it all in a completely lawless environment. So how do you create a world for your movie to work? You make City of God. A quick warning, if you haven't seen this film, I suggest you shut this video off and go watch it, because spoilers will be coming your way. That, and you're missing out on a terrific piece of art. So what's so special about City of God? Well, the thing we're going to be looking at today is what always stood out to me, and that's how alive this film feels. City of God is the epitome of how to make your environment a character of your movie. And when telling a story where your movie's narrative is dependent on your setting, making the surroundings a reflection of the plot is a very effective cinematic technique that should be used more often, and City of God was a benchmark on mastering this technique. We watch as the characters grow, so does the city. Now, we've seen films of this style before with ensemble casts and lots of stories to tell, or films with a reflective and evolving setting.
But where'd you get the midget?
And there have been great movies that fuse the two, like Boogie Nights, as well as the movie that popularised this style of filmmaking, Goodfellas. Although I feel that City of God did this form better than any other movie I've seen. That's right, I'm saying City of God out Goodfellas, Goodfellas.
You fucking piece of shit.
A lot of the excitement and vibrancy in the world of City of God comes from the fact that what's happening off-screen is just as important as what we see on-screen. We're aware that things are going on around us that aren't in the frame, or sometimes even in the scene. So let's see how City of God creates this free-form evolving environment, or what I like to call the open world movie. Number 1. City of God has a ridiculous amount of characters, and sometimes that can be enough to make you feel as though you're in a moving world, just because there are so many individual stories to focus on. But that's not what makes these characters influence their surroundings. Here's what the filmmakers did. Treat all characters with the same importance. In this movie, no character is given more weight than another, because that way, we feel as though every character has an important role to play, as we take their actions more seriously. And a great way to convey this is by how you introduce your characters to a scene. Normally, if a character has an important part to play in a story, they're introduced with some gravitas. But not in City of God. Look at this scene, and how Knockout Ned, arguably the most important character of the movie's climax, is introduced. He turns from the camera, says a few mumbling lines, then drifts out of frame. And this becomes our main character. When characters appear here for the first time, it may not be obvious that they're relevant to the plot. Characters are typically introduced in backgrounds, or just referred to in flashbacks.
Era um moleque chamado Cenoura.
The camera may whiz by them for a second to establish them in a scene, or in the case of Stakes' character, introduce his first scenes in but a few flashes of a montage. By treating your characters like this, you remove any obvious bias towards the key players, and therefore everyone seems important. So when we then see these important characters in the backgrounds and outskirts during vital events, it adds a sense of realism, because your characters feel as though they do inhabit your world, as they don't just appear at the important events that they are involved in. In an open world, you should envision how your characters live their lives. Have them wandering around the city, because the more they interact with that world, the more that world becomes tangible. This is why chance encounters work so well in City of God. Take note at how many different characters interact with one another over the course of the movie. It's quite a lot. If you want characters interacting with one another, try and have as many interacting with one another as possible. This heightens the sense of connectivity that your world has, because then everybody has some sort of relationship. The more associations you develop in your world, the more authentic it becomes. Some of the best scenes in cinematic history come when the protagonist interacts with the antagonist. So, give all your characters the opportunity to explore this kind of chemistry. It's great to see Rocket encounter the Runts walking through the supermarket, or Tiago and Snake conversing, because it feels as though the world is moving. And because you've already established that all your characters carry some weight in the plot, nothing feels like filler. It becomes comfortable when characters drift in and out of scenes, because it shows a constant involvement with the world around them. Angelica interacts with Tiago, Tiago with Benny, Benny with Zay, Zay with Ned, Ned with Rocket, and so on and so on. The more connected the characters are with one another, the more intimate your world feels. If your cast is going to be this big, make sure it's utilised properly so that they link your world together. The other way City of God does this is to not have one character be the sole focus of a scene. In every scene, you'll notice that it's never just about one person. There'll always be another character there. Having one person never be the focal point keeps things alive because of the then knock-on effect of any plot point. Think about it. A large event happens and it affects one person. But what if it affects two? Or how about 100? If you want everything in your world to link, have a number of characters experiencing the same event. That way the knock-on effect of that plot point affects more people and is spread throughout your world. At Benny's death, all the characters affected by this are present because the film used a party as the setting. If you think a plot point will affect a character, don't have a scene explaining to them what happened, create a scene that requires them to be there. So when the equilibrium of the film breaks, we don't need to see scenes of how this affected people, because they experienced it firsthand. A reaction scene should only be included if it really is important. When creating an open world, your characters are what hold it together. You may want your world to be vast and freeform, but it still needs to be cohesive, and your characters are perfect for this. The personal relationships they have with one another link the entire world and give it the depth that it needs. Number 2. The traditional narrative arrangement of a movie as we know it is plot point A, plot point B, climax, conclusion. But City of God doesn't follow this formula. It plays out more like a series of vignettes, with every character as the protagonist in their own story, and so there isn't an obvious goal for our characters to accomplish to reach a happy ending. But this gives some advantages to how City of God structures its chain of events. Let's look at a specific plot point. Why is Ned killed? Well, because Otto wanted revenge for the murder of his father. Ned killed him because of the exception to the rule. The rules were established because Ned joined Carrot, he joined him because he wanted revenge on Zay, and so on and so on. These events are loosely connected, but we can still see that the story is based around cause and effect. And sure, this approach may also ring true in other movies and other genres, but there is still an overarching main story being told there. Movies like City of God and Goodfellas don't have that obvious beginning, middle, and end. What this does is give the movie free rein on showing whatever and whosever story it wants to. Following a more traditional narrative structure limits what you can show in your world, because you have to show what's important to your main story at a specific time. That typically means a handful of characters in a handful of places. In City of God, we can travel wherever we want because the snowball-like plot influences everyone in this connected world. This allows the movie to cut to wherever the biggest impact a story element has had and gives us much more freedom to explore the world. Developing the story across various locations in your world is a good way to enrich it, but City of God expands on this by having the cause be in a different location to the effect. By showing how one event can influence someone in a completely different area, you create a world that feels expansive. And if your film has the advantage of not needing to show any establishing information, then don't. City of God keeps things moving by avoiding a lot of exposition, and this can be best shown in the editing. What this movie does is cut at the end of one scene to the middle of another. We never see characters discovering something in City of God. The beginning of a new scene is often halfway through an event that was already going on before we even saw it. This keeps things in the film moving and services the idea of a constant changing world, as it gives the filmmakers more time to focus on the things that matter. This is also complemented by the movie's omniscient narrator. Rocket narrates the story, but by doing so he allows us to see events that not even he was present at. This once again frees you from the limitations of what you can and can't show in the story, because who's to say you can't cut from a casual conversation to a prison break? That's how the narrator's telling it. So what we can take from this is that the editing and structure of an open world movie has to service the scope of your setting. You want to give as little limitations to your story as possible so that your audience can see as much of your world that you've created. Which leads us to number 3. The whole purpose of this is to show how you can create an evolving world that the audience feels involved in. So first, you're going to have to familiarize your audience with the environment. That way they're able to associate themselves with it and thus become more engaged. This is a difficult task to pull off in an urban environment, yet City of God pulls this off with a very simple technique. Find landmarks and show them. This is the closest that City of God comes to establishing shots, And typically in a movie, this can be such a pet peeve. You see so often in films, if you cut to a major city, it will be very blunt with you. But City of God shows us that you don't need that. All you need is to find distinctive locations and show them on occasion, whether it be an alleyway, a small plaza, an apartment complex, and so on and so on. This gives the audience comprehension of the world, because by recognizing parts of it, we're able to visualize its layout more. And so in the final scenes, when our main character is running through the streets, we can piece together where he is in the world. It feels like he's really going somewhere. This setting would feel a lot more convoluted if we only saw unique locations on every scene. But it's one thing to believe in the world, so how do we become involved? Well, first of all, we have to see everything. This is where the narrator comes in handy, because he can tell us things that we need to know and gives us a reason to show them. This way, it feels as though things are developing throughout the city, even when we aren't there to witness it. This is what I mean by the peripheries of the movie being just as important. Just look at this scene. It didn't need a split screen, but it adds to this idea that the world outside of what we see is alive. A split screen is a fantastic way to demonstrate this. But probably the best way to involve your audience is perspective. City of God is shot in a documentary-like style. Everything handheld, everything moving. But it's not just a case of unnecessary shaky cam. The camera actually has a personality. The director Fernando Morales didn't give his actors marks for where to stand in most scenes, and so the camera wouldn't know where it would go next. This means that during scenes, the camera looks around the setting, replicating the audience's actions. The audience would be overwhelmed if they were in this world, so the camera shows that. During a lot of the montages, the transitions from one scene to the next is often just the camera whizzing around the area, taking everything in. It acts as a person, including double takes. And sometimes looking completely upside down. We're right in the middle of the scene. When you shoot in this kind of style, you can put the audience in the shoes of the characters, having them see exactly what the character sees, but more importantly in scenes like this, exactly what the character doesn't see. Immersion is essential in creating a world for your audience, because if they can't identify with your world, then how could they believe in it? But if City of God has shown us anything, it's that every environment can become relatable. So if you're a filmmaker and want to make something in the same vein as City of God, think about your own open world movie. Get across the idea that what happens off screen is just as important as what happens on screen and how you can convey this. Treat your setting as a character and have your audience familiarize themselves with it. Don't add any plot elements that can limit you in what you can show. And treat your supporting characters with the same care as your lead cast, because in the city, anything can happen. Combine everything that we've mentioned and you can have an open world movie. And who knows, you just might make the next City of God. My favorite movie of all time.